Assalamu alaikum students. Today it's our fourth lecture. We will be learning another drug carrier system called neosomes. Following are the contents of today's lecture. In this class we will be studying about the introduction to neosomes, structure of neosomes, types of neosomes, preparation of neosomes and method of preparation, characterization of neosomes, advantages of neosomes, neosome versus liposomes, and pharmaceutical application of neosomes. So let's start with the introduction first. Paul Ehrlich proposed the idea of drug targeting or drug targeted drug delivery system to the disease cell without damaging healthy cells in 1909. And this strategy has been known as the magic bullet. Since then, a number of drug carrier systems have emerged, including immunoglobulins, serum proteins, and synthetic polymers, liposomes, microspheres, and even the drug carrier that we are actually studying today, neosome. Reducing the size of the drug carriers to the nanoscale have many benefits, including improving of the pharmacokinetic biodistribution of therapeutic agents, reduction in toxicity by accumulation of the drug in the target site, and facilitating the drug passage between the cells, and increasing the interaction time in biological systems that increases the efficacy of the drug. To create a new drug delivery system, two requirements must be considered. Number one, the drug should be released in accordance to a programmed rate. And number two, it should release effective amount of the active ingredient at the target site. Doses of the traditional forms are not able to meet these goals. In general, vesicular system is a drug delivery platform that actually enables effective bioavailability of drugs through controlled release of therapeutic drugs for a prolonged period of time. The main purpose of the development of vesicular structure is modification of distribution profiles to control the release of drug in a sustained way and targeted delivery of the drug to the particular body site. Vesicular systems that are able to accommodate large amounts of drugs and create an acceptable surface for targeting enables the drug to carry both hydrophilic and lipophilic components. Neosomes are actually vesicles of non-ionic surfactants, for example, alkyl esters and alkyl ethers, and cholesterol that act as a carrier for amphiphilic and lipophilic drugs. So let's repeat this definition. What are neosomes? Neosomes are vesicles of non-ionic surfactants. For these surfactants may be alkyl esters or alkyl ethers, and cholesterol that act as a carrier for amphiphilic and lipophilic drugs. Neosomes improve the therapeutic performance of encapsulated molecules by protecting the drug from harsh biological environments, resulting in their delayed clearance. Let's study the structure of neosomes. Neosomes are spherical and they consist of microscopic lamellar, unilamellar or multilamellar structure. The bilayer is formed by non-ionic surfactants with or without cholesterol and a charge inducer. Different types of surfactants at variable combinations and molar ratios are used to form neosomes. Examples of these surfactants are alkyl ethers, alkyl glyceryl ethers, sorbitan fatty acid esters, polyoxyethylene fatty acid esters. Addition of cholesterol maintains the rigidity of bilayer, resulting in less leaky neosomes. Meanwhile, the charge inducers provide charge to the vesicles and increases the vesical size, thereby increasing the drug entrapment efficiency. There are two kinds of charge inducers that are being incorporated into the neurosomes. Negative charge inducers, including diacetyl phosphate and dihexadecyl phosphate and lipoamino acid, and positive charge inducers include sterylamine and cetylpyridinium chloride. They actually helps to stabilize the vesicles. Non-ionic surfactants in neurosomes tends to orient themselves in such a way that hydrophilic face end faces outward to the aqueous phase, and hydrophobic end faces inward to each other to form a closed bilayer structure which encloses the solutes in aqueous solution. Here you can say that polar head groups are regions are actually phased outward, and the non-polar region is phased inward, which is forming a bilayer structure. In this structure, like that of liposome, you can entrap drug hydrophilic drugs in this aqueous region, whereas hydrophobic drug in this hydrophobic lamellae. As a result of this closed bilayer structure of neurosome, hydrophilic inner and outer surfaces with a sandwich lipophilic area in between exists. To form a closed bilayer structure, energy such as heat or physical aggregation is required. Various forces inside the vesicles play an important role in maintaining this vesicular structure. For example, van der Waal forces and repulsive forces that exist among the surface molecules. Varying the vesicle components, including type or composition and concentration, the size, shape, surface charge and volume will likely modify the properties of the resulting neurosomes. There are various types of neurosomes which are mentioned in different references. They can be classified according to the size of the neurosomes, like small unilamellar vesicles and large unilamellar vesicles, or the number of bilayers, like multilamellar vesicles. Based on these factors, neurosomes can be classified on these three types: multilamellar vesicles and large unilamellar vesicles and small unilamellar vesicles. Multilamellar vesicles, they consist of number of bilayers surrounding the aqueous lipid compartment separately. The approximate size of these vesicles are from 0.5 micrometer to 10 micrometer, and these neurosomes are most widely used because of their simple preparation and mechanical stability. When they are stored for long period of time, they show mechanical stability. These large unilamellar vesicles are the type of neurosomes which have a size range of 100 to 3000 nanometers. They have a high aqueous phase to surfactant compartment ratio. Accordingly, the bioactive material can be entrapped with a very economical use of membrane surfactants. These are small unilamellar vesicles. Generally, small unilamellar vesicles are produced from multilamellar vesicles by various methods such as sonication or extrusion under high pressure and high pressure homogenization. The approximate size of small unilamellar vesicles are from 10 to 100 nanometer. There are different disadvantages of small unilamellar vesicles. they are highly unstable thermodynamically. They tend to aggregate, and generally the amount of the loaded hydrophilic drugs in this group is low as compared to other types of neosomes. There are other types of neosomes which are present apart from these unilamellar, multilamellar and large unilamellar vesicles. One is called as Bola neosomes. Bola surfactant compounds have two hydrophilic heads that are connected by one or two long lipophilic spacers. The Bola surfactants have much lower surface activity, but they create a strong assembling ability, which is determined by much higher surface tension and lower critical muscle concentration than the conventional counterparts with the same composition ratio. Bola neosomes show a suitable tolerability, and in this group of vesicles are actually made up of alpha omega hexadecyl bis 1 as a 18 crown 16 which is called as a Bola surfactant with span 80 and cholesterol. All these three ingredients are present in the ratio of 2:3:1. There is another type of neosome which is called as proneosome. The proneosomes are obtained from water soluble carriers, and these carriers are coated by a thin film of dry non-ionic surfactants. The carrier should be safe and non-toxic, free-flowing and poorly soluble in the loaded mixture solution. And it should have a good water solubility for ease of hydration. The examples of these type of carriers include maltodextrin, sorbitol, mannitol, glucose monohydrate and lactose monohydrate and sucrose stearate. Proneosomes are dry formulations that should be hydrated immediately before use. An important advantage of the proneosome is the reduction of neosomal physical instability, such as aggregation, fusion and leakage of drug in overtime. On the other hand, it is easier to work with proneosomes as powders. Let's proceed further. The preparation of neosomes. This is the diagrammatic representation of neosome which is shown to you. Theoretically, neosome formulations requires the presence of particular surfactants and additives and aqueous solvents. The aggregation of surfactants, surfactant monomers into vesicles on hydration is actually the result of high interfacial tension between water and lipophilic portion of the surfactant. The surfactant molecules tends to be oriented in such a way that the hydrophilic head groups of the surfactants are pointed outward, whereas the lipophilic tails face each other to form the bilayer. The opposite forces leads to a supramolecular assembly that is shown over here. The other essential components in the preparation of neosomes are additives such as cholesterol. There are various methods of preparation of neosomes. We would be studying a very few of them. Thin film hydration method, bubble method, ether injection method, handshaking method, sonication method, and reverse phase evaporation method. So let's start one by one with each of these methods and their elaborations. First method is thin film hydration method. It is highly efficient, simple method that is commonly used in the preparation of neosomes. The surfactants as well as additives such as cholesterol are dissolved in organic solvent. If the drug is lipophilic, it would be added simultaneously. The solution is mixed in down bottom flask under vacuum and at a certain temperature. A thin film is formed on the wall of the balloon. by removing the organic solvent under the condition. For hydration, water or phosphate buffer solutions or phosphate buffer saline is added to the mixture at a temperature which is slightly above the phase transition temperature of the surfactant. At this point, a hydrophilic drug is added to the mixture. There is another method which is called as the bubble method. In this method, organic solvents are not used. Surfactants are added along with the additives and transferred to a three-necked glass reactor. That is shown over here, a three-necked glass reactor. To control the temperature, the reactor is placed in water bath. Nitrogen gas enters the first neck. The thermometer is positioned on the second neck and the water flux is in the third neck. These components are mixed for 15 seconds with a high shear homogenizer and immediately afterwards bubbled with nitrogen gas at 70 degrees Celsius to yield neosomes. Here you can see the whole assembly that this is a three-neck bottle glass where one neck is for water cold reflux, one neck is for the insertion of thermometer to control the temperature and one neck is for the nitrogen supply. This is immersed in a water bath in order to maintain the temperature. Once the homogenization is done, the neosomes are formed. The homogenization is carried out for around 15 seconds and then nitrogen is purged into this bottle flask at 70 degrees Celsius to yield the neosomes. The third type of method is ether injection method. In this method, a solution containing a particular ratio of surfactant and cholesterol in an organic solvent, for example, diethyl ether, is slowly injected into an aqueous solution supplied with the drug, which is kept at a temperature above the boiling point of the organic solvent. Gradual evaporation of the ether causes the formation of neosomes. Depending upon the reaction conditions, the diameter of the neosome is between 50 and 100 nanometer. This method has been used for the entrapment of drugs like rifampicin. The neosomes prepared by the ether injection method demonstrated the entrapment efficiencies slightly higher than the neosomes prepared by handshaking method. On the other hand, increasing the cholesterol content in the formulation results in the decrease in entrapment efficiency of microparticles. This may be explained by the fact that every fractional addition of the cholesterol produces gradual increase in the rigidity of the vesicles. The uniformity of shape depends on the hydration time and temperature. By increasing the hydration time, the shape and size of the neosome becomes more uniform. Handshaking method is another type of method of preparation of neosome. This method is very similar to the thin film hydration method and produces multilamellar vesicles. In this method, the component surfactant additives are dissolved in an organic solvent that is evaporated by a rotary evaporator to form a thin film on the inside wall of the flask. Dry films are hydrated with aqueous solution of phosphate buffer saline at specifically a pH of 7.4, containing the drug for about 1 hour with mechanical shaking to form neosomes. Sonication method is also used for the preparation of neosomes. Sonication is an effective method for the production of small vesicles. In this method, providing high energy by sonication can reduce the average size of the neosomes. There are two ways to the sonication. Number one is the probe sonication, which is employed for the preparation of suspensions in small volumes, whereas the bath sonication is more suitable for the formation of a large volume of dispersions. The solution of drug in the buffer is added to the surfactant and cholesterol mixture in 10 ml glass vial, and this dispersion is then probe sonicated at 60 degrees Celsius for around 3 minutes. Here in this diagram you can see a probe sonicator where a beaker is being used, and this same assembly is used for probe sonication, which is explained over here. Reverse phase evaporation method. Controlling the size of the neosome is the advantage of this method, whereas the solubility of the drug in the ether and difficulty of complete removal of the ether from the final formulation are drawbacks of this method. The fundamental trick of this method is the elimination of the solvent from the emulsion by evaporation. In order to form an emulsion, a solution of cholesterol and surfactant is prepared in a mixture of ether and chloroform with a ratio of 1:1. The aqueous phase containing the drug is added to this mixture, and the resulting two phases are sonicated at 4 to 5 degrees Celsius. After sonication, a buffer is added, and consequently a clear gel is formed. The organic phase is evaporated at 40 to 60 degrees Celsius and at low pressure. The viscous suspension of the neosomes is then diluted with the phosphate buffer solution and heated in water bath for around 10 minutes at 60 degrees Celsius. The hydration process continues until the evaporation is completed. Large unilamellar vesicles are formed by this method. This method is explained over here with the flow diagram and flow chart. What we have learned over here, that first we make a solution of cholesterol and surfactant in a proportion of 1:1, including ether. Then it is sonicated at 4 to 5 degrees Celsius. The sonication results in a clear gel formation. This is treated with phosphate buffer saline, and again that is sonicated at 4 to 5 degrees Celsius, and then ether removal or chloroform removal is carried out, and finally after heating it on water bath at 60 degrees Celsius for 10 minutes yields the neosomes. Physicochemical characterization of neosomes is needed to control the quality of the product. There are various physicochemical parameters that are being analyzed to check the quality control of the neosomes. Morphology and size. Determination of neosomal size is a necessary quality control assay, because this factor is very effective on the biodistribution and plasma pharmacokinetics of the neosomes. Neosomes are usually spherical, and their size can be determined by various techniques like dynamic light scattering technique, which is called as DLS, transmission electron microscopy, which is called as TEM, and scanning electron microscopy, which is called as SEM. The charge of the vesicles in zeta potential is another factor. A zeta potential is very important in the behavior and properties of vesicles. It should be considered carefully in the preparation of neosomes. The HLB values of surfactants are very effective on zeta potential. As a result, a trend towards the more negative values is noticed with increasing the HLB values. Neutral neosomes are more unstable against aggregation and fusion than charged neosomes. Membrane rigidity is another important factor, and it is attained by the addition of cholesterol in the neosomes. It can be determined by the mobility of fluorescence probe as a function of temperature. There are different advantages of neosomes. It would be best to say that there are various advantages of neosomes. Neosomes act as a reservoir to release the drug in a gradual and controlled manner. Number two, neosomes are osmotically active and stable. Also, the stability of the drug over long storage times is much higher as compared to the liposomes. They are improving the medication taking behavior by the delayed clearance of the drug, by protecting it from biological environment, and by restricting its effect on the target sites only. Neosomes have low toxicity and high compatibility with biological systems because the commonly used non-ionic surfactants are biocompatible, biodegradable, and non-immunogenic. Fifth advantage of neosome is that the neosomes can be administered through various routes of administration. The oral bioavailability of the drugs with low absorption has been improved by neosomes, and neosomes also increases the permeability of drug into the skin. A wide variety of drugs, both hydrophilic and lipophilic, with different solubility can be entrapped in the neosomes. Neosomes are effectively used to deliver various drugs to the target organs. Neosomes are flexible and easily modified because of its functional groups which are attached on the hydrophilic heads. Storage and handling of surfactants does not require special considerations. So these were the advantages of the neosomes. Let's move towards the comparison of neosomes versus liposomes. Both are similar in structure, but they do have certain similarities and dissimilarities. So let's see how they do differ and how they do have similarities with each other. Neosomes and liposomes, they both have the same structure, that is a bilayer vesicle, but they are different in unit components and chemical properties. The basic structural component of neosome is non-ionic surfactant, whereas the phospholipids are the basic structural components of liposomes. Both the structure have the same performance as carriers, and they can be used in sustained and targeted drug delivery systems. Both neosomes and liposomes display similar behavior and interaction in the living cells by prolonging the circulation time of the entrapped drugs and altering the distribution and metabolic activity of the drugs. Neosomes show better chemical stability because liposomic ingredients like phospholipids are chemically unstable. Liposomes require special methods for storage, handling, and purification of phospholipids, whereas neosomes do not require any special storage mechanisms. So these were the differences between the neosomes and liposomes. But the major difference between these two is in their cost. Neosome is less expensive, whereas liposome is more expensive due to the special methods for storage, handling, and purification of phospholipids. There are various pharmaceutical applications of neosomes. Neosomes are used for a variety of routes of administration, and neosomes can be used for a variety of applications as well. They can be used for administration of drug through oral route. Neosomes can be incorporated in transdermal drug delivery systems. Ocular delivery of neosomal encapsulated drug is also possible. Drugs are administered to pulmonary and nasal routes using neosomes. Neosomes can be used to deliver antineoplastic agents in cancer therapies. Neosomes have been used as cutaneous gene delivery systems for the treatment of variety of skin diseases. Neosomes are used as drug carriers for targeted drug delivery to various tissues. Immune neosomes are vesicles with antibodies attached to their surfaces, and they are used for immunological applications for various disorders. Neosomes are capable of protecting the peptide drugs from enzymes of gastrointestinal tract, thereby making it easy to deliver the peptides through neosomes. Neosomes are used as carriers of diagnostic agents for X-ray imaging. So these were the applications of neosome, and that's all for today. For any questions and queries, use your HULMS portal. Or you can also take a screenshot of the part that is difficult to understand and kindly email it to my official email address, and then I'll be answering you after the completion of activity of the whole class. For completing this part of lecture or this class, you will have 3 working days. Mark your activity completed and email me your questions so that we can combinedly discuss all the queries related to this topic. Thank you for patiently listening to this lecture. I'll see you and I'll discuss all the problems with you in online Skype class. That's all for today. Allah Hafiz.